This week on the show, we will be interviewing GNN of the FreeBSD project to talk about the new TeachBSD initiative. That plus the latest BSD headlines, all coming your way right now. BSD Now, episode 136. This is GNN, recorded April 6, 2016. Hey, I'm your host, Chris Moore.
And I'm Alan Jude.
Yeah, glad to have you guys with us this week. We got another exciting show this week. We got a cool interview, which you'll have to stick around for. I know we've talked to GNN before, and he's a lot of fun, so we will be happy to bring you that interview in a little bit. But before we get to all that, there is a lot of news to get to this week. Mm-hmm. We actually had some, a big release finally dropped. It took a little while for the release announcement to show up. But a FreeBSD 10.3 release has definitely landed now. Yep. And I guess it was kind of a worst kept secret ever because it was out on the mirrors. And like
I think it wasn't.
A week before.
Yeah, so was I. But I think it wasn't quite on all the mirrors yet. A couple things like that. But yeah.
Cool. Well, it looks like it has definitely dropped. And not only that, it looks like it's landed with extended support until April 30th of 2018.
Yes. So. This is the typical cadence where .0 is short, 1 is long, 2 is short, and 3 is long. But because of changes coming up, this is probably going to be the last extended support release that will happen. Starting with FreeBSD 11, which should start release this summer, the new support model rather encourages people to make the minor version upgrades. Because of the ABI stability, you know, if you upgrade from FreeBSD 10.2 to 10.3, you don't have to, you're not forced to upgrade or recompile, you know, any of the other packages you have installed. The ABI is compatible, so all your apps will still work. So even if you have, you know, a proprietary app or something that was specifically compiled for FreeBSD 10.1, it will still run on 10.3. And same even for like driver modules. So like if you have hardware that comes with a binary driver module and it was compiled specifically for, you know, 10.1, it'll work on 10.3 and you'll be okay. Mm-hmm. And so because of that, doing the minor upgrades from, you know, FreeBSD 10.2 to 10.3 isn't a big risk like it is with some other operating systems. Right. And so in order to make supporting versions of FreeBSD easier, starting with 11, the new support model will be that support for, you know, 10.2, or well, 11.1, say, will end about 2 months after the next version comes out. So once 11.2 comes out, you have 2 months to upgrade to 11 from 11.1 to 11.2 before it stops doing security updates for 11.1. Because this will be, you know, it's a matter of hopefully for 11 running package upgrade, but you know, FreeBSD update and doing the minor upgrade. And then a reboot or whatever, it hopefully will help keep people on the newer versions, which is good. But it'll make the support team, or like the security team's job much easier because they don't have to try to support, you know, a two-year-old version of FreeBSD. And more importantly, I think it'll help things like the ports tree where they don't have to support, you know,
keep building stuff for those old things.
Yeah, like some of the graphics improvements and stuff we've been waiting on were really held up by still having to support FreeBSD 8.4 until it finally at the end of last year.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it'll help a lot to help the project move forward. But at the same time, the major version, like FreeBSD 11X and the stable 11 branch, will still be supported for the same 5 years. So it's not like we're pulling the rug out from vendors or something. You know, you'll still be able based on the stable branch and know that everything you compile will work for 5 years, the same as it does now. It's just doing it in a way that will make the job of the security team much easier.
Cool. Well, yeah, that's definitely going to be something to look forward to with going forward to 11. So I guess some of the new features we need to talk about for 10.3. I know we've probably, just like OpenBSD, we've probably touched on these in different episodes over the last couple of months as they've landed. But these are some of the specific ones that landed in 10.3. So, of course, the UEFI bootloader has been improved, supports booting root on ZFS, and the Beastie menu.
Yeah,
so is very cool to see.
Thanks to all the people that worked on that, like Eric McCorkle and Steve Hartland and Thomas Soom, and I think Warner Losh worked on a bunch of it too. So mm-hmm. not just does it have, you know, support for ZFS and so on, but the support for even booting UFS was improved a lot, and it supports the config file now and a bunch of other improvements. Yeah. And just in general, it's much better. It has support for setting the right resolution on your laptop a lot better, all mm-hmm. kinds of improvements. And so it's much nicer. And it has support in the installer now.
That is good. That is good. So, of course, speaking of ZFS boot environment support landed as well. So that's a big one. I guess that's now an official thing. I guess we can say FreeBSD has boot environment support out of box.
Yep.
Is that how it's set up that way, right?
The installer's been laying out the thing like that since like 10.1. But now the menu lets you pick the boot environment as you boot. Still some tweaks to go on there, but most of those actually go in the BAdmin utility rather than in the menu, so that'll be easy to update because it comes from a port.
Sure.
The CAM target layer, or CTL, now supports a high availability mode, which basically allows you to be able to fail over your storage node to a second machine much more smooth. It's very fancy.
Was that some work that Mav did,
yes.
I think, for FreeNAS?
Yeah. It's really good stuff. The design was done quite a few years ago by someone else, but the code never really arrived. It was just like some basic stubs, and Mav actually built it all, and I'm excited to get to play with that.
Yeah, that'll be neat.
The 64-bit Linux emulation stuff was ported back from 11 to 10.3, so that's available now. Mm-hmm. There's still a little work to be done in the ports to make those a little easier to use. Currently, it defaults to installing the 32-bit ports, and you have to custom compile, like you have to build it from ports with some flags set to get the 64-bit version.
Which we're doing that with our next package set for April, nice. By the way, for this current image.
Because you're 64 only. Well, the only thing that would break is any binaries that are 32-bit only, like the Flash plugin. But I think you guys used Pipelight for Flash now anyway, don't you?
We stopped using Flash, so we don't ship it anymore. Okay. So I'm more interested in seeing if Skype works.
I think the Skype will be a 32-bit binary, and so might not work with only the 64-bit stuff installed.
I thought there was a 64-bit version that worked.
I'm not sure. But the solution for that that's being worked on is having these. If you're on 64-bit, it will install both the 32 and 64-bit ones because they don't conflict. They're actually use separate libpaths, kind of like lib32 on FreeBSD, but the other way around.
What is it? Compat Linux? Compat Linux 32?
Well, no, it's just inside Compat Linux. They have lib is where they put all the 32-bit stuff, and they have lib64 for all the 64-bit stuff. So like on FreeBSD, except for FreeBSD, lib is always the native, and then there's like lib32 for the compat, whereas in Linux, they always shunt the 64-bit stuff into a special place. But anyway, once that work's done, that might make it a lot easier to do that. The reroot support has landed. Basically, this allows you to boot off of, say, a small file system or an MFS image or a RAM disk or whatever. And then it's not really a reboot, but basically you restart all of user land with a different root. So it basically restarts init with a different slash as the root.
Which would make sense in the case of upgrading a boot environment. For example, if the kernel didn't change, you could potentially do the quick shutdown reboot.
Yeah, that would work. You can also use it for booting off iSCSI. You know, you can pixie boot to a little RAM disk and then reroot into the SCSI, iSCSI or NFS or something like that, and a bunch of other interesting cases. I've also used it on my little Onion Omega thing. It has 60 megabytes of flash, of like NOR flash built into it. And so I can burn a kernel into that, but it's not actually a rewrite file system. So I'll boot the kernel and a basic user land off of it, then reroot onto a USB stick that has a whole user land on it. I could have it just boot directly off the USB stick, but maybe it's not attached. So this way at least boots into a system, a read-only system that I could actually SSH into. But if it doesn't fail to reboot, if the USB stick is there, then it can reboot off, reroot onto the USB stick and give me a full user land, which is nice. It's pretty cool. Also,
this one I'm excited about. The XZ support, multi-threaded, finally.
Yes. So when you're using XZ to compress stuff, you can use all of your cores to do the compression, so get done a lot faster. The output file is slightly different if you use threads than if you didn't. So they won't have the same checksum, but it is very nice. And basically, it just chunks up the input thing and spreads it out. And it,
you have no idea how frustrating it is when you got 16 cores and you're compressing like VirtualBox images to ship.
Yeah, and you're using one of the cores. You're
watching it on one core.
It's like, well, I could try to do 16 of these at once.
So annoying.
Yeah.
That's a good fix.
Yeah. Then Sessutil, which is a utility that Baptiste and I built based on some previous work by Mav and some other people. And it uses the SCSI enclosure services to talk to backplanes and so on for your storage nodes. So, you know, if you have a big machine with like 12 or 24 or 36 or 90 hard drives, and they have little blinking lights for all the hard drives. Sessutil allows you to map all that out and figure out where stuff is. You can map device names like, you know, DA37 to which slot it is actually in. And you can get information about like fans and stuff in the backplane. But the most important thing is being able to blink the little LED for the hard drive that has died so that the guy standing in front of it can swap out the right hard drive instead of the wrong hard drive.
Yes.
That's a big thing. And so
that is a big thing.
I was glad I got to help build that. Then that's cool. Various ZFS updates, everything that's changed from since FreeBSD 10.2. And then a huge number of driver updates like network cards and storage cards and all that stuff.
And before people ask, I've had people already run this by me. No, this is not the Haswell stuff.
That's 11. That wasn't ready in time.
Yes. So anyway, keep looking forward to 11.0 for all those fixes.
Yep.
Okay. Well, shoot, there's a lot of new cool stuff. So if you're not already running 10.3, if you didn't see it early last week or whatever, go grab it now. There's no reason to wait.
Yep.
You know, fire off your upgrades. I've already done it on my routers here and I think almost all my systems. So
yep.
It's working well.
Yeah, we've been doing that at Scale Engine as well. Some of them going directly from 9.3 to 10.3.
Oh, wow. Okay. So a big jump.
Well, we need the ZFS features.
That's right.
Yeah. So if you're on any of the 10s already, the upgrade is a minor one and is really not risky at all and is very much worth doing. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not going to disturb anything else on your system.
No, it's pretty minimal.
Yep.
Okay, well, let's move on to the next story here. So this is something that we've not mentioned a whole lot, but LibreBrute, for example. Mm-hmm. Those who don't know what that is, that's basically a replacement for BIOS or UEFI. And it's not closed source, so it's something, hence the Libre and the name there. But we have a tutorial here, or I guess detailed instructions on how to use OpenBSD with LibreBoot, which is really cool. It's one of those things, if I had unlimited time, I'd love to sit and play with a LibreBoot system just to see what happens.
Well, in particular, so I have the a ThinkPad X220, and the BIOS won't boot if I put in a different Wi-Fi card.
Oh,
you know, originally,
so you're thinking.
Well, the Wi-Fi card it has is a good one that's supported, the 6205. But I purposely bought one of the like 7260s, the newer one that wasn't well supported back when I bought it, in order to help test and so on. But as soon as I put it in the laptop, it's like, invalid hardware. I'm not going to be.
I don't support this.
Yeah. Even though it's, I replaced an Intel with an Intel. It's not like I was putting in something strange. It was just, it's new enough that the BIOS of the older laptop didn't know about it. So it's like, if I could Libre boot, then I could do whatever I want with my hardware, and this would be much better.
And that does sound enticing.
Yeah.
Like I said, there's good reasons I think people want to play with this, and I know I'd like it, but unlimited time, maybe someday.
Yeah. And so with this story, the big thing is that now that OpenBSD has EFI support, and because of that, I had to get support for the EFI frame buffer. You can. That means you don't have to have the VGA BIOS binary blob anymore, because you're going to just use the EFI frame buffer instead.
Sure.
And so that means you can use an unmodified LibreBoot release without having to worry about any binary blobs.
That is cool. That is cool. So it looks like they'll need to do a little bit of preparation, some steps to make it all work. Mm-hmm. But since of course the regular install 59.fs won't work. Because BSD.RD and OpenBSD doesn't have the frame buffer console. So
yeah, it seems like their RAM disk is small and for the installer image doesn't actually do EFI.
Yeah. But either way, it's still doable. And if you go ahead and take a look at the post, you can get all the gory details on how to get that set up. And of course, this is interesting to those who don't want to rely on binary blobs to boot their system. So definitely take a look at it. Try it out. I'd be curious to see other BSDs run this as well. I'm surprised we haven't seen like a NetBSD running in.
Yeah.
That seems like that would be right in their ballpark, you know?
Yep. But. So with this, they have instructions of three different ways you could get OpenBSD installed without having to deal with the frame buffer problem. You could build a different BSD RD RAM disk. So basically build your own installer image that would have the frame buffer support. And then you would be able to just do the install normally. Or you could use the regular kernel in conjunction with a different BSD RD or whatever. Or you could put the hard drive in a different machine, install the OS, and then just boot it with the frame buffer on the X200 or whatever. And so they kind of walk through some of the steps for that and show how they got it working.
Yeah, those are all valid ways. Whatever's easiest, I guess, for you. Mm-hmm. So it's nice that they provide alternative methods to do the same thing. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, moving on, we have a post here about linking the FreeBSD base system with LLD. We have a status update. Oh, that's interesting, because I know there's been ongoing talk about this at previous developer summit in the last couple of years. But the FreeBSD Foundation, Ed Mast, has provided an update to us on the LLVM mailing list about the progress of replacing the GNU linker with the LLD in the FreeBSD base system.
Yeah, so this is the linker that's part of the LLVM Clang suite.
Mm-hmm. That's right. So one of the quotes here, he said, I'm pleased to report that I can now build a runnable FreeBSD system using LLD as the linker for build world and with a few workarounds and work in progress patches. I have not yet extensively tested the result, but it's possible to log into the resulting system and basic sanity tests. I've tried are all successful. Note that the kernel is still linked with the LD.BFD.
Yeah, so the original, the previous LD.
Linker. Okay.
So then he kind of provides an outline of what's still missing. One of them is symbol versioning support. FreeBSD uses symbol versioning for like its libc to provide backwards compatibility with older versions so that if you fire up a FreeBSD 6 binary on your FreeBSD 10 system, it can, you know, the newer libc can pretend to be the older libc. If the, you know, extra arguments were added or whatever, the old version is still available. So there's a open PR for that in LLD, and support for that will likely be added. Then for building the FreeBSD kernel, the kernel uses some linker scripts that have more complicated expressions and are supported by LLD. And so there's a PR open for that, and hopefully it will gain enough compatibility to build the FreeBSD kernel as well.
Oh, interesting. Library search paths is an issue, I guess. GNU LD automatically searches /lib. But LLD does not. That seems like an easy fix.
Yeah. So the like user lib libc or whatever in FreeBSD is a linker script that lists all the other places to search. But the GNU one automatically searches /lib and the LLD one doesn't. And so it could be explicitly added to the one in user lib, but you know, it seems like that could be worked around. LLD from Clang doesn't have the capital N flag, which makes the text and data sections read-write and does not page align the data. And this is used extensively in the bootloader components.
That makes sense.
And so that flag would be nice to have. Then the DC flag, which assigns space for common symbols when producing relocatable output with minus R. It's used extensively in the /rescue binary, which is a single binary assembled from a collection of different utilities. Basically, it's one big statically linked binary that has
a bunch of hard links.
Many hard links to it, but it has all the utilities you might need to fix your system, including like sh, ls, fsck, and like 80 other ones in one binary that you can just have on your system and use, even if all of your libraries are broken and everything. They don't depend on anything except for what's in that one binary. And, you know, having recently broken a path on a Linux machine where I needed, I couldn't do ls or mv or anything because on CentOS 7 now, /lib is just a symlink to user lib. And so when I was trying to switch, the install had made /home the big partition, and I wanted /usr to be the big partition with home just being under it. And when I renamed some mount points or whatever, I was temporarily didn't have a /usr directory, and now no commands worked at all. And they didn't have something like /rescue for me to fix it. It's like all I need is enough to be able to like you know, rename a file. And so, but no utilities were, oh, it was terrible. Anyway, yes, that, and then the capital Y flag adds a path to the default library search path. In FreeBSD, this is used for the lib32 build, which builds the lib32 or i386 builds of all the system libraries so that you can run 32-bit binaries on your FreeBSD. But yeah, with all the ongoing work, it might be possible for FreeBSD 11 to actually be built and used with LD, but it probably won't be switched on as the default because it's it won't have enough time for testing.
People will play with it for a while first, yeah. Maybe. I don't know if that's something they could do in an 11.1 or is it required doing in 12, though?
For that,
is that a big enough
change? I don't know. For switching the default might have to wait, but I'm sure it'll be an option. It already is an option in your like source.conf too. Sure. So, you know, if you want to build with less GNU stuff, you can start to do that already, but you can't do the kernel cool, quite though. Yet. But yes, it's interesting to see this work. A note from the LLVM people saying that FreeBSD currently looks like it'll be the first operating system to actually be able to be built with it.
Oh, that's fantastic. Mm-hmm. That is great. Well, of course, we will keep an eye on that and let you know as these issues get resolved. And hopefully here in the not too distant future, we'll be telling you how to flip the switch and go ahead and try it yourself on your current head. Okay, well, next up, this is a story. Maybe you saw it in a non-news site or just kind of around the net this last week. But of course, your favorite billion-user companies using BSD just turned on encryption for all their users, and it only took 15 engineers to do it. And we have a link to a Wired article actually talking about a WhatsApp. So tell us a little bit about what happened here. And I'll just tell you, I'm a WhatsApp user, and I saw the little notification go by on my screen the other day, like, hey, this conversation is now encrypted. Yay, that's awesome. And running BSD makes me have warm fuzzies inside. So what exactly are they using? I guess signal encryption, Alan?
Yeah, so from Moxie Merlin Spike's Open Whisper Systems, their signal encryption thing. So it's actually public-private key, like basically the equivalent of GPG. And so there's a public key server run by WhatsApp, and that's where all the users have their keys. But you can actually... kind of like a GPG key signing party, like we sometimes do at BSD events. If you're meeting someone in person, that you can get on their screen, their WhatsApp will display a QR code or a string of numbers that they can send you or read you over the voice or whatever. And you can then scan that, and then you know that, all right, this key is definitely actually Chris Moore, who I've met in person and verified by looking at his passport or whatever. So that when I'm talking to you, I'm not just assuming based on the phone number or who appeared online. I know that I took the QR code from your phone, and I'm sure that I'm actually talking to the real you, which is the step that a lot of other things, we have encryption. It's like, well, how do I know that I'm actually talking to the right you, right? There's more to encryption than just encryption. It's also proving that the person on the other end is who you think they are. And they also have a way to do it with voice too. So you can, if it's someone you're not going to meet physically or whatever, they can basically read you those numbers over the phone and you can recognize their voice or whatever.
That's cool.
And stuff like that. So yeah, it looks very interesting. And yes, it's also interesting that, because they're using FreeBSD, they only have 50 engineers to run all their enough servers for a billion users. And, it only took a small team to build the encryption thing. And I think part of the reason the number was even as high as 15 is because they made it work on all the different platforms, including iOS, Android, Windows phones, even old Nokia like S40 and S60 phones, older Blackberries and the BB10 and all that. Almost every phone that you can think of has encryption supported now.
I wonder if it's in the web interface, too. I don't know. To look at that. Yeah. I would imagine so, if they've gone to all the trouble for everything else.
But yeah.
That is cool.
It's nice to see something that, they didn't just build this in-house. It's something kind of more standard and open-ish and based on the right cryptographic primitives of actually having, it'll be interesting if this ends up being the way that GPG finally becomes usable by mere mortals. Mm-hmm.
That's true. No more key signing parties? Is that not?
Well, it's basically you have that key
you
signing
have
your
party. Phone QR code.
But yeah, it's just your phone and a QR code or a number you can read over the phone.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's really cool. Hopefully other things become that easy to use in the future. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, so definitely check it out. Wired article is actually pretty well detailed.
Yes, it is.
Well worth the read, so take a look. And if you're using WhatsApp, you'll even see the little notices. So maybe click that, and they have a good description on their site, too, about what they've done, what they've turned on.
Yeah, and they have the backstory of how this all happened, which is like the reason that, you know, WhatsApp kind of wanted it for a while, but the kind of kickstart that actually caused it to happen was a family reunion of somebody who didn't work at WhatsApp. It's a great story. Anyway, it's definitely worth the read to get the insight on the people behind it too and their motivations, and it makes a lot of sense.
Cool. Okay, well, it's time to get to our interview here in just a second, but before we do, let's mention the first sponsor this week, which is going to be IX Systems, and of course the website for that, ixsystems.com/BSDnow. You want to go there, check it out, get in touch with their sales engineers, and let them build you a system of awesomeness, whether it's a small little FreeNAS Mini to the new FreeNAS Mini XL, which just launched and we're going to talk a little bit about and give you some of the specs on. I think Alan might have some pictures.
I have pictures
and stuff. But definitely want to check it out. And when you call those guys, get yourself hooked up with one of those boxes. I have one coming in the mail here soon. Ooh, I'm so excited.
Yes.
So looking forward to it. But definitely get in touch with those guys and let them build you anything, whether it's, again, a mini XL or anything up to a crazy system with, you know, terabytes of storage and who knows what. I mean, they'll basically talk to you and figure out what your exact needs are and then design the system based around that, not just sell you something they already have boxed up sitting on a shelf, which is what you want in your storage vendor. So, okay, Alan, walk us through a little bit some of the FreeNAS Mini XL and give us some pictures and stuff.
This is basically for people that had a FreeNAS Mini before. You know, I got the side-by-side picture. You can see there's the Mini and there's the new Mini XL. In particular, the only downside to the FreeNAS Mini was that you could only fit 4 hard drives. Ooh. And so they fixed that. So the Mini XL will support up to 8 hard drives that are hot swappable, plus has 2 internal 2.5-inch bays for SSDs.
Nice.
Yes. So you get your...
So how would you recommend setting that up? Like,
it depends what you want. I think they come empty by default, but you could set it up with an L2 ARC and a ZIL or mirrored L2 ARCs, or really depends what you want to do.
Sure.
So it gives you the 8 hot swap hard drive bays, so you can have up to 48 terabytes depending on your RAID layout that you use. You get the 8-core 2.4 gigahertz Intel server CPU with AES and I, up to 32 gigabytes of DDR3 with ECC with the optional upgrade to 64 gigs of RAM.
Ooh, nice.
Yeah. Support for RAID Z1, Z2, ZFS mirrors, ZFS stripes, etc. Optionally, you can install L2 ARC or a S-Log to get your caching. The power supply will take anything from 100 volts to 240, so that's good in US, Japan, Europe, etc., everywhere in the world. The total power consumption of the whole thing is only between 60 and 80 watts, depending how many drives you put in it.
That's next to nothing for what you're getting.
Yeah. Plus, it has the web browser management system, plus full IPMI because it's a server-grade motherboard. Without drives, it weighs 23 pounds.
Nice.
Well, and it has
really looking forward to the box showing up.
Yep, and you see it supports all the things you might want to use it for, including the full REST API and everything. But what you really want are the pictures. So here's what the front of it looks like. You can see it's very sleek. Mesh at the front to keep dust out, but let air through. And it can lock it. And then here's the side view. You can see it's actually not that deep, so it's not going to take up a lot of room, you know. Even though it's twice as tall as the old one, it's still a mini. So when you open it up, you can see you got your 8 hot swap drive bays, all nice and tucked in there. Even the USB ports are behind the key, so somebody can't just stick something in there. Here's the back. You can see you get your dual gigabit network cards or network ports. Although there is actually the option to upgrade to up to dual 10 gig NICs.
Ooh.
That's fancy. In the spec sheet here somewhere, yes. 2 gigabit network cards with the optional upgrade to 10 gig.
The question is, why haven't you bought one yet? You need this like right now.
Yeah.
This is a very worthy upgrade.
Yep, plus serial and VGA and so on. And there's some more shots of the front of it, and you can see lots of little LEDs to let you know what's going on. Because we all know that the quality of a server is basically just the number of blinking LEDs.
That's true. That is true.
Yeah. So there's the front and back. You can see very fancy.
Nice.
You know, very much looking forward to getting to play with one of those.
For sure. For sure. Yeah. Same here. So speaking of playing with one of them, you'll want to stay tuned to next week's episode. Word is we will have something special to show you with regard to this FreeNAS Mini XL. So stay tuned next week for that. Okay, well, we're joined today by George Neville Neal. So first of all, you've been on the show before, but we appreciate you coming back and taking the time here in Tokyo.
Always happy to talk to you guys.
Oh, great. Well, we're going to talk a little bit about TeachBSD. So I think we've mentioned it on an episode weeks ago.
It's been a while. When we released the website, yeah.
Yeah, but go ahead and fill us in a little bit. What exactly is it?
So TeachBSD.org comes from some work that Robert Watson and I started a couple of years ago. So Robert and I were talking about the fact that, you know, operating systems isn't really taught the way we'd like it to be taught, you know, which is true of anything that's taught. And we thought, well, what we should do is develop open source teaching materials, because most people who are teaching anything, but professors at universities, if you give them the material to start with, then they'll teach with it, right? And so one of the goals of the TeachBSD work, of course, is to get people to be using BSD in universities, because that's where we'll get new developers from. But also because we felt that there were some innovations we had in FreeBSD that would be really useful to help people who are teaching operating systems.
Sure. Okay. So I guess the website launched a couple weeks or a couple months ago now?
A few months ago now.
Yeah.
So the original two courses that we did were a graduate course, which is what Robert wrote and is teaching currently at the University of Cambridge.
Right.
He taught the first version in the spring of 2015 in whatever they call their spring semester, and he's teaching it again. He's in the middle of teaching it right now. At the same time, I developed a practitioner course, which we've just taught for the second time here at AsiaBSDCon, and actually Alan just took it. So that's the basic material. And then the idea was that we wanted to put the material, all the material up in an open source format. So unlike source code, we can't use a BSD license directly because you have to have a different copyright for written material versus code. But it's a very similar open license where people are welcome to take the material and use it. We always like to find out if they're using it. That's one of the nice things with open source, is to get the feedback.
Sure.
The current two courses are a graduate level operating systems course and then again this practitioner course, which started out as a two-day course, will eventually be 5 days of material. And that's all, you know, teachbsd.org is the front page to it, but it's all really hosted in GitHub. So people can go to GitHub. There's a TeachBSD organization. GitHub has these organizations. And they can find the course GitHub repo there, and they can pull it, fork it, branch it, whatever they want to do.
So you accept patches
and pull accept patches, and we've actually gotten patches and pull requests, mostly for, you know, spelling mistakes, things like that. But, you know, so that material went up, I guess, in December or November or December. The year goes by very quickly.
So give us a tease, I guess, a little bit. What's in some of the courses? What are you guys touching on, and how advanced is this?
So in terms of the graduate course, it is a what we would consider, I think, a typical graduate course that you'd find at any university. So if a university has a computer science department and they're teaching operating systems at the graduate level, you know, you'll find the same kind of material. The innovation in the TeachBSD work is that we're actually using D-trace.
Okay.
So Robert broke this down very well. There are sort of a few teaching styles to traditional operating systems courses. And when I took operating systems many years ago, and up until the present day, there are a few styles. One is what we call trial by fire. So, you know, you give a bunch of undergraduates, or sometimes graduates, but usually undergraduates, you know, an operating system to work with, and then you have them do something like add or modify a device driver or modify the scheduling algorithm. But the reason that's trial by fire is you've just given them multiple millions of lines of code and very little guidance is where to look. I mean, you might say, oh, well, you're going to look at the scheduler, and you'll talk about that in the class. But you're giving people who may or may not be really proficient in C.
Sure.
A lot of undergraduates now start in Java. Yeah, well, we're all going to make the Java face. That's okay.
Yeah.
But they won't start in something like C, which is, you know, definitely going to burn your fingers. And at Cambridge, this is particularly a problem because they have 3 8-week trimesters per year. Mm-hmm. So they only have 8 weeks with the students. In the States, we have 12 to 14 weeks with the students. But even then, if you're talking about an undergraduate course, you know, you get someone who's taken a one-credit course on C. Maybe they learned C++ instead of Java as their first programming language at university. And then you're giving them, you know, no memory protection, no process mm-hmm. containers, single address space, kernel, and all they're not all they're going to do.
Frustrating commands.
Yes. Right? All that's going to happen is they're going to be really frustrated. We don't want that to happen. So that's one style of trial by fire. Then there are people who've gone the other direction with sort of toy operating systems. And, you know, many universities have developed these. The University of California, Berkeley had, I think it's TinyOS might be from them. Various universities around the States, Canada, other places. I know that one of the big schools up in Montreal developed its own sort of little toy OS to teach operating systems. The problem with that is, okay, you've gone from millions of lines of code to probably a couple 20,000 lines of code.
Sure.
But then you're missing all the things that make operating systems interesting. You're usually missing asynchrony.
Mm-hmm.
You're not working with a real world object. So you can learn some bits of theory, like you might, you know, put in a new memory allocator and see how that works. But you're not going to be able to run that system with any significant workload. You won't be able to run a real web server on something like that. So you won't learn as much from the sort of the tiny toy operating system thing. And then the third style is sort of one of the typical graduate student styles, is that many graduate courses on operating systems don't have you write much code at all. What you do is you read and review papers, and then you write summaries of past research in operating systems. You talk about that kind of stuff.
More theory.
Yeah. And a lot more just review of papers. So what Robert and I realized with DTrace was that here we had this thing that was incredibly safe to use, right? It would show you nearly any part of the kernel you wanted to look at. And we could actually have students run experiments on the kernel, right? So in the graduate course, you know, there's three sections. The first section is sort of an overview of the kernel and of DTrace, how tracing works.
Sure.
And then processes and virtual memory take up the second part. And then the last part is networking, TCP mm-hmm. in particular. And in 8 weeks, you know, the labs do take the students through using the tracing system to showing the effects of I/O on L1 and L2 cache, and you know, looking at what happens when you pick different buffer and page sizes, things like that. And then the third section, they actually derive the TCP state machine diagram by tracing TCP states using DTrace. So in 8 weeks, they're able to go through, you know, two or three significant kernel subsystems. They're able to write lab reports about what they found. They're able to run real experiments. And you know, that's just a really powerful way to teach, right? Because now they're working with a real, what we call a real world artifact, right? Mm-hmm. Something that they would see, you know,
in
enterprise. Yeah. Right? FreeBSD runs things like Isilon and NetApp and Juniper and the PS4, since we're in Japan, we can talk about that. You know, and so they've worked with a real world system, but they've also been able to do something significant. It's not, you know, back when I took OSs, I think the final project was, you know, make a line printer driver. Of course, there are no more line printers.
Yes.
you know, it's a much smaller project. Whereas derive the TCP state machine, you know, if you had to do that by writing a bunch of new C code, you'd never be able to do that in the 2 or 3 weeks you have remaining in the class.
Sure.
On the practitioner side, we find the same thing to be really helpful because, you know, in a 2-day course, you don't want to have people, you know, install an operating system and then start, you know, in a 2-day course, no one's going to be able to write a bunch of C code, right?
Sure.
What you get out of a lot of practitioner style courses for operating systems is, you know, looking at data structures, looking at theory, which is fine, or doing, you know, like a long code reading. Kirk McKusick has a class he's run at UC Berkeley Extension for many years, which I took a long time ago, which is a code reading class at the BSD Now FreeBSD kernel.
Mm-hmm.
And that's great, but that's, you're not doing a lot of interacting with the software.
Sure.
And so with DTrace and that, you know, with using tracing, in a 2-day course, we can actually have the students, and we do have the students, do multiple just sort of short half-hour labs. It's like, oh, here, let me show you how, you know, certain things work in the file system. We'll look at the name cache, which is what we looked at the end last night. Here, let's look at the name cache. Okay, well, let's write some D scripts, very short D scripts, and then, you know, my synthetic examples are things like running find on the file system.
Sure.
And then we'll watch how that works. Mm-hmm. So, and that's the key innovation, I think, of this, is using DTrace to be able to give people a full tour of the operating system. And then, yeah, if they want to go in and really mess with the code, that's great. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the longer-term goal. The other nice thing is that, you know, as we were talking about at the end of the class last night, you can apply these kinds of things to build a course for DevOps and SysAdmin, right? So people who aren't going to modify the kernel but have to understand its performance and have specific things they want to know about, that's another great direction we could go.
Yeah, like it seems like it takes the operating system and puts it in like plexiglass so you can actually see what's happening inside of it.
Yeah.
And learn to understand how the practices work together without having to build your own from scratch.
Right. Or, you know, if you imagine when the first time any of us did a lot of C code, you know, we just make a lot of dumb mistakes.
Sure.
And you can go down a blind alley for a long time, right? And as particular as we retarget some of this material for undergrads, we're going to develop an undergraduate course. That's really important because that's what typically happens when an undergrad OS course goes wrong. Mm-hmm. Is that, you know, they go down the wrong alley, and then you've got a class, you know, undergrad classes are 30, 40 people, is a lot of people.
Sure.
And there's TAs, but they're not going to be able to help everyone. And the goal of it, you know, of educating people isn't to just, you know, grade them. It's to get as many people as possible to understand what you're talking about. And that this idea that it's in plexiglass, they can play with it, means that, sure, we want to give them some real programming. We might give them one real programming example in a 12 to 14-week course. But for the first few weeks, we can make sure that they're always with us, because they're not stuck in a lab somewhere banging their head on the desk. Sure, right? That's what we want to avoid.
It's like, I made this change, and now all my kernel does is crash.
Right.
Yeah, I've never used a kernel. I've never debugged a kernel before, so right. I don't know how to go from here and figure out what I did wrong.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the thing we'd really like to get past. So one of the other things I've been doing with the material is I've actually been, it's part of working on TeachBSD, is I've been approaching universities to try to get them to adopt the coursework. So I've given some talks at some universities in Athens, because I happen to have some connections there. Went to Chulalongkorn, which is the largest university in Thailand. It's a huge engineering university, 35,000 undergrads.
Oh, wow.
Gave a talk to a bunch of their professors, plus professors from other universities, about the teaching approach. And, you know, it's really, this is an evangelist role as well, where we're like, we've produced all this material, we'd really love you to use it, it's completely open source, it's free to you, please send us patches. And, you know, our goal is to get this out there as much as possible.
Mm-hmm. Do you know if anyone's already started to uptake it?
I've been looking, watching how many people fork it.
Okay.
So I've seen that on GitHub. It's generally getting course material into universities takes a while.
Sure.
So we've only started pushing it out towards, you know, we had the website up only a few months ago. I've started giving the talks in the last few months. It's going to take a year or two because, you know, for someone to basically pick up a new set of material, adapt it to their own environment, decide which books to use, things like that, and then, you know, change the material in the department is going to take one or two rounds, and that would only ever happen in the West it would happen in the fall, and in Asia it would happen in the spring. So the reason we meet here at Asia BSD in this month is because their school year starts in April.
I didn't realize that.
Yeah,
okay.
Most people don't know
there you
go. Who don't come from here. So I think it's going to be 1 to 2 years. There are some universities, I mean, obviously Cambridge is using it because Robert's teaching it. We have been working with the University of California at Santa Cruz. There's a couple of professors there, Daryl Long and Ethan Miller, who haven't taken our material, but actually have started teaching with FreeBSD.
Oh, okay.
They switched over their OS course to FreeBSD. I had known them for quite a number of years, and they approached me out of the blue and said, we really want to switch. What should we do? And I'm like, oh, here, let me help you as much as possible. So I think in the next couple of years we'll see more uptake as we get out there and as more people pick it up and more people learn about it.
Okay, so what kind of resources are there for, say, professors that want to teach with this course but maybe haven't used FreeBSD a lot themselves to get them up to speed to be able to feel comfortable teaching this material?
So one of the things that's actually in the materials in the GitHub repo is a teaching guide.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very typical to, when you write a textbook, you do this This is relatively common when you write a textbook. You'll produce a teaching guide that goes with the textbook. And actually, the earlier BSD books, the 4.3 BSD book from the 80s, and the I think the 4.4 BSD book also had this, they would come with the answers to exercises as a printed book for the professors. Mm-hmm. So you know, we're producing the teaching guide, marking guides. We need to figure out a way to basically open source some of it, but not put all of the homework online, because the students will just take it, right? I mean, that will just happen. One of the ways we're thinking about doing that is working with our publisher, Pearson, who puts out the design and implementation of the FreeBSD operating system, version 1, version 2, second edition. Pearson has behind a login system for this kind of material.
Sure.
So we'll probably work with them putting that up there. And we've been giving them material as it goes. They also have all of this material to give to professors. And we're really hoping that when they go out to start talking to professors about what they're going to teach in the fall, that they'll also bring this material with them. So we produce the material for Pearson, and then Pearson's sales force will be, they go out, I think, at the end of spring is when they start talking to professors about what they're going to do for the next year into the fall. So there'll be marking guides. There already is a teaching guide that we've started. And that all of that, except for the homework, is in the GitHub repo.
Well, being an open source project, one thing open source projects always need is more contributors. So
yep.
Is there anything in particular you guys are wanting to have worked on or are looking for new members to come and get involved with?
So we definitely want anyone who has an interest in teaching this stuff, whether they're at a university or not, to come take a look at the material, give us pull requests, send us email. There is an email address, info@teachbsd.org, where people can email, those of us who are working on it. And as the team grows, that will be a team email.
Sure.
At the moment, it's just Robert and myself. The thing that's going to be hardest about this is going to be producing the undergraduate course.
Mm-hmm.
So, Robert, of course, does teach undergraduates. I teach practitioners. I don't teach undergraduates. And it's been a long time since either of us were undergraduates.
Sure.
So being able to target the material really is going to need collaboration from people who are teaching, younger people.
Mm-hmm.
So we definitely want people to get involved at all levels. If people want to share material, they can send it to us. If they're willing to share material online, we're willing to take it. We'll take a look at it first, obviously, to make sure it's appropriate. One of the other things that's interesting, and I discovered this by visiting some of the, you go to a Cambridge or a UC Santa Cruz or a university in the US or many parts of Europe, and there's more resources.
Sure.
Right? So one of the things we do in the graduate course that Robert did is he uses actual hardware. So each of the students has a couple of BeagleBone Blacks, which they can use to do these networking experiments, and they can do performance analysis because the real hardware has the PMC driver stuff.
Sure.
And the practitioner course I teach with virtual machines because they're just so easy to bring up. It's like you show up the first day, everyone's got a laptop. I bring four of the 10.2 release images on a USB key. And I'm like, if anyone doesn't have an image, just start this up. But to do performance stuff, you really need real hardware.
Sure.
So BeagleBone Black is great. It's something like $50 US. Well, if you go to, if you really want to push this into a lot of universities in countries that are not the USA, Canada, Europe, we want to push it into places like, for instance, Brazil or Thailand or places like that, then what we need is a cheaper platform.
Okay.
So we've been starting to look at that. We'd be really interested in talking to people who build those about the kinds of things we really want to see. Almost all of those things, like the RPi 0, and now there's an RPi 3, and then there's all these other boards, they're still targeting that $35 to $50 range. The 0 is cheaper. And there's the Pine 64. But people who are going to produce boards in the $5 to $10 range would be really interested in what they're doing. In particular, most people leave off networking, right? Because it's expensive. It's an expensive part to put on there. And we want to make sure we teach networking as well as things like file systems and other things. So we'd like to find a really cheap board. And where I mean really cheap, like if I could get $5 boards, I could get a lot more of this stuff out there.
Sure.
And I think it'll eventually get there. But in terms of material, what we really want is to talk to people about their experiences in undergraduate teaching, because that's going to be the big new job for us. And I'm, to some extent, leading that. Robert is extremely busy both with research and teaching graduate students.
Sure.
So I have I have said that I will lead the charge in doing the undergraduate class, but you know, I'm not a professor. I just play one on TV.
Would you guys then eventually maybe roll out your own images for these cheat boards or whatever, prep for teaching BSD?
Yes. So one of the things we did for the graduate course, which was interesting because we got the postdocs to do a lot of the work, of course, that's how you get work done at universities, was we produced an SD card image.
Okay.
So, and that would be produced using, you know, Jenkins continuous integration every week because we'd be making fixes and changes. And also we created the synthetic workload programs so that they were mostly doing analysis. And we'd give them the whole thing on an image. And we will definitely produce that. Right now, for the practitioner course, I'm just using the defaults. Yeah. But it actually was pretty clear from our experience the last couple of days that it would help if I put a bit more tooling on those.
It's kind of pre-ready to go out of the box.
Yeah. So right now, if you look at the teachbsd.org site, I think we point directly at the current release V images, the virtual machine images, to say, well, if you want to just try this out, try it here. But I think we would produce, they're not incredibly specialized images, but somewhat specialized images to, you know, for people to try it out, because then people can actually do the material on their own as well. One of the other things that we're working on now is producing video. So a few of the talks I've given have been recorded. Robert and I have been talking to, you know, various people around Cambridge to possibly record him teaching. Because again, much like the written material, we're willing to share the video, you know, just put it up online, put it up on YouTube or Vimeo or wherever it would go. It would be appropriate so people could watch it themselves and follow along. So if someone wants to, you know, spend the time and the money to spend a week with the two of us recording us and getting, you know, a really professional version of that, that would be also a great help.
Sure.
Not many people are, you know, prepared to do that kind of work. It's quite a bit of work. I've edited my own video. It's not very fun.
Yeah. Maybe we have a listener out there who can do that. So get in touch with us. We'll get you in touch with George if you can't find him. We'll make that happen.
That would be great.
And there might be value in something like a troubleshooting guide for, you know, students that are taking the DTrace course and they run into this error or that.
Well, that's an interesting point. I suspect that will come from reworking a lot of that DTrace stuff in the FreeBSD handbook.
Right.
But it's an interesting idea to sort of have an FAQ kind of thing for, you know, welcome to your class on FreeBSD, here are the things that could possibly go wrong.
Yeah.
Although, with an operating system, the things that could possibly go wrong, very large. Yeah. Yeah. It might be easier
but
for you to
specific ones, yeah. If you get this error, it's because, you know,
this
you
is what's going
DTrace this right.
Exactly. And I think to that point, having a troubleshooting guide is good, but probably having, you know, really good tested images, where it's like, okay, we know that if you just turn this on anywhere, and, you know, if you take this box and this image, or you take this VM and this VM type, it'll just work. Yeah, and actually, interestingly enough, I may try and do a Beehive type image. We'll see if I do that, because that would, well, so there's Xhive on Mac now, which I've got working with all of the stuff, and to me that's kind of interesting because that, you know, if you go to a classroom now, you don't see Windows boxes, right? You see a few boxes that might be running a BSD or a Linux, and you mostly see glowing apples.
Sure.
So, you know, that's definitely a place to target. The other thing that would be good about something like Beehive as a virtual machine system for this is, you think about a university that, you know, doesn't have the money to get everyone a Beehive, but they could have one big server, which they probably do, that could run something like FreeBSD, where you could have automated Beehive images.
Yeah.
Because automating most of the other, except for ESX, automating most of the other virtual machine kind of stuff like VirtualBox is not the easiest. Beehive is really just scripting, and that would make, you know, bringing up the images for all of the students in a lab environment pretty easy.
So is there any thought about some of the, like, the PMC stuff that you do in the other course into the practitioner side, or the virtual PMC?
So the virtual PMC stuff in the practitioner course is harder, because then we'd have to specify which virtual machine technology, because each virtual machine technology exposes different counters differently, and you're going to get really different results. So the nice thing about handing everyone, say, a BeagleBone Black or whatever the next platform is that, you know, same frequency, same memory, same L1, L2, they're all going to see the same effect. It's possible that if we picked, you know, in the centralized server idea, like if you've got a lab full of people all using the same box, that you could get something that would be okay that way. But it's, I think it's just really hard to give people good results. You give them some experiences in the PMC stuff, which is nice, but you couldn't get them to do science,
right?
Because the science would just change around too much. Now, if you look at some of the networking classes that the folks like Masmiano teach or Philip, who's here, teach, you know, they walk around with a rack, like a little rack full of stuff, and that's another possibility. Mm-hmm. But I think that's pretty far off.
Right. Well, hey, we appreciate you telling us all about this, and we'll have to check in a couple of years and see how this has evolved and what the uptake is.
Hopefully sooner than that. I guess we'll see how it goes.
Okay.
Thanks.
Yeah, great. We appreciate it.
Hope you guys enjoyed the interview with George. I know that's a lot of fun, and thanks for taking the time to talk with us, George. We appreciate it. But we need to get into the news roundup. But really quick before we do that, of course, another sponsor this week, which is going to be DigitalOcean. Of course, the website for that, digitalocean.com, which is fairly self-explanatory. But you want to go there and get signed up, you can create an account. Oh, it only takes you maybe a minute or not very long. Yep. Not asking for a lot of your time here. Mm-hmm. But once you've created that account, don't forget to use the coupon code FreeBSD now to get your $10 credit.
Yep.
So you can run basically the lower end VM for 2 months, which is really awesome considering a low end VM comes with SSDs backing it entirely.
Yep.
And still a terabyte of transfer for the month, which is just fun.
Yeah, it's probably enough to do whatever you want to do.
Yeah,
well, and if not,
we do Mumble for video game days. We have game days here. We do a Mumble server. We do mail backup. We do a Quassel core up there. So
yeah, and I have backup mail server, status page for company, all kinds of stuff. Plus, you know, they have all the other sizes depending what you need.
That's right. That's right. So plus, definitely check.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
You get to pick your location.
That's right. So I think I put mine up. New York was the closest ping
yep.
to me or something, which works good for a Mumble server.
Yeah, because so. They have San Francisco, New York, Toronto, London, the Netherlands, Germany, and Singapore. And a new one coming up in India sometime relatively soon.
Oh, really? Yep. Okay.
And
that's cool.
You know, you get DNS management, all SSDs, the ability to transfer snapshots and images of your machines between those locations. And private networking inside each of those locations.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Plus, they have definitely. Like you said, they have a speed test site, so you can test which of those locations has the best speeds to you, if that's what you're worried about.
Yeah, or you know, pick the one that's farthest away if you're trying to do backup or something weird and you want to send it far, far away. But it's really cool. They let you set that all up. Of course, they have a nice HTML5 web interface. You can access the console. So you can, of course, out of box, they support FreeBSD, which is cool. But if you're not wanting to do FreeBSD, you can do Open. You can throw Dragonfly in there. I think Net as well. You can do pretty much anything you want. And if you really have to, maybe some Linux if you're desperate. But anyway, you definitely want to throw some BSD up there. And if you talk to them, let them know you heard about it here on BSD Now.
Yep.
Okay, so let's get into the news roundup here. So the first one this week. So it's been a while since we've had a new entry into the Faces of FreeBSD series that the FreeBSD Foundation has done. But due to popular demand, it looks like it's back. So this installment features developer Scott Long. So for those who don't know Scott, he currently works at Netflix. He's previously been at Yahoo and Adaptech as well.
Mm-hmm.
But Scott got a very early start into BSD, which I think now, this is right up there with the earliest you can get, but he discovered i386 BSD version 0.1 on an FTP server at Berkeley back in 1992. So I guess when you say ground floor, that's pretty much it.
Yep.
But he said from there, it's pretty much been a journey, and he's been following along ever since FreeBSD version 1.0 landed in 1993, which is pretty slick. Mm-hmm. So, you know, a little, it's a not too long of an article, but I just wanted to pull this one quote out here of what stuff we can blame Scott for. So in his own words, he said, "I've been a source committer since 2000. I got my start by taking over maintainership of the Adaptech AAC RAID driver. From 2002 to 2006, I was the release engineer and was responsible for the 5.x and 6.x releases. Though the early 5.x releases were not great, they were necessary stepping stones to the success of FreeBSD 6.x and beyond. I'm exceptionally proud of my role in helping FreeBSD move forward during that time." He said, "I authored and maintained the MFI and MPS storage drivers and the UDF file system driver and several smaller sound and USB drivers. I have maintained or at least touched most of the storage device drivers in the system to some extent, and I implemented multi-grained locking on the CAN storage stack. Recently, I've been working on overall system stability and or scalability and performance," which I can imagine Netflix is just slightly interested in that. Well, very cool. So definitely check that out. Yeah. We're glad to see if those are back.
In particular, the MPS driver is the one that almost every storage machine running FreeBSD uses.
Yeah.
And
slightly important.
Also, random note that just came up the other day. For April Fool's, Nginx did an April Fool's joke about having support for like FreeBSD 2.2.9 or something.
Okay.
And it was a reply to a release announcement. And I was slightly confused because I didn't see this April Fool's joke. And then when I looked into it, it turns out back in 2006, so 10 years ago on April Fool's Day, when Scott Long was the release engineer, he did an April Fool's joke of announcing the release of FreeBSD 2.2.9, which, you know, at this time they were releasing FreeBSD 6. So,
sure.
And so, yeah, it just goes back to when he was a release engineer, he did a release. And then 10 years later, Nginx built on that to do their own April Fool's joke.
Talk about the inside joke of all inside jokes, man.
Yes. It's like we're making inside joke about something that happened 10 years ago about a release that was actually, you know, 10 years before that.
That's incredible.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I thought that was good.
Definitely check it out, though, and we're glad to see it. The faces of FreeBSD, I guess, series, if you want to call it that.
Yeah, it's been a series. Quite a few people on there. Have you been on there yet?
No.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
maybe we'll have to.
You're going to get an email soon, I bet.
You had to go say something, Alan. Okay.
Well, I've already done mine, so.
Right. Well, okay. Well, if they ask, we'll make that happen.
Yep.
Okay. So tell us about this next thing. I guess we have a fancy ASCII art site. I mean, who doesn't like that?
So this came up in the FreeBSD chat room the other day. I think it was John Baldwin was trying to draw a diagram for his slides for something. And he was running into some difficulty. And he was like, well, originally it was done with like the GIMP or whatever, you know, basically the open source alternative to Photoshop. And somebody's like, well, why are you using a raster program to draw a diagram anyway? And it went on and on and on. And then somebody was suggesting the old, you know, Unix utilities like Fig and so on to actually draw ASCII art images. And then somebody, I think it was Conrad Meyer, linked up this ASCII flow, which is this tool where you can draw ASCII art. So you can create little boxes, and then you can create like lines.
Hmm.
Or you can create lines with arrows on them. Or you can go completely freeform and just draw whatever you want. And it has a little eraser so you can erase stuff. And the resize tool actually lets you resize stuff after you draw it, which is kind of a big deal. And you're, you know, it's like, oh, I ran out of room. Whoops. And then you can type different font sizes. And all the stuff you might want to do.
This is pretty cool.
You know, I can definitely see for the type of diagram, like showing the how a block is actually laid out in ZFS and stuff. All the diagrams are based on this, or like even just what a TCP/IP packet looks like.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, you can have each square here be a byte, and you can show it, and you know,
basically all man pages that use diagrams should be using this.
And you can import and export as ASCII text, and it also has an option to save to your Google Drive, so because the website here doesn't provide any storage.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, with import and export as plain text, it works great.
This is really cool.
It's just, you know, really ingenious to, you know, being able to do stuff with ASCII is one thing, but the thing that sold it for me was the resizing of boxes.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, yeah, I don't know another.
I mean, I don't have to do that in VI anymore and manually go around.
It's like, oh yeah, I wanna, so I have to like space over every line when I want. Yeah,
this looks so much nicer.
Exactly. It's very.
Well, we hope that helps you out if you guys have to do any ASCII art.
Yeah, I'm expecting to see a trend in BSD presentations at BSDCAN of lots of diagrams done with ASCII flow.
I would hope so. That just seems like a logical next step. Let's do that. Okay, so next up we have a system under test, FreeBSD. It looks like we have a new series looking at testing across a number of projects. This is over at lowlevelbits.org.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks like they're doing an outlines of testing framework of FreeBSD, and they provide a mini tutorial on how to run the tests.
Yeah.
So anything you want to tell us about this one, Alan? Any specifics to jump out?
Right. The series started by looking at how testing is done in LLVM, right? So it's not just looking at operating systems, but other things. But yeah, so they looked at the different tests that are available on FreeBSD, the frameworks like ATF and QA, and so on. And they ran the test. Now, they did note that it didn't seem like that was very many tests. There was only like 3,700 tests for something as big as the operating system. There are some more tests that they didn't find, but that's not their fault. They're just not documented very well. I think it's they're under like user source tools regression or something like that. Like there's a whole set of tests for the Geli disk encryption thing. Because when I made changes to that, part of the pre-commit workflow that Powell recommended was actually running through those and making sure that I didn't break anything.
Sure.
And so on. And so, yeah, you know, it'd be great if somebody documented some more of those tests and helped write more of them and so on. I know there's a couple of people working on that, and they'd love to have more help.
For sure. Yeah, definitely check that out. Curious. I might have to take a peek through some of that since I'm doing a lot of QA stuff here now. Mm-hmm. That's cool. Okay, so next up we have the worst April Fool's joke ever, which I don't know if it's the worst. It's funny.
Something like that.
Right?
So this is over from Ryus.com, and they say, obviously they're talking about April Fool's Day here. Today, Microsoft announced that it would require FreeBSD. FreeBSD is an open source operating system known for its very enterprise-friendly license. Microsoft has recently embraced open source by moving the .NET framework over to GitHub, as well as announcing Bash will be available in Windows 10. However, this move is quite unexpected. Microsoft is paying the FreeBSD Foundation approximately $300 million for the FreeBSD brand, the open source operating system source repositories, all the forks and sub-brands, including OpenBSD and NetBSD, the websites, and the community. I'm not quite sure how you buy a community.
Well, enough beer?
Yeah. Microsoft is in the process of negotiating salaries with many of the developers and so on. Then there's a rumor here that they would buy iX as well.
Well, you know.
But yeah, and then they have a quote here from Microsoft CEO saying, "With Apple using so much FreeBSD source code in their OS X operating system, we felt owning part of the OS X operating system source code could really help us, our Office developers, make sure they could write better Office port for OS X."
Wow.
As a, in further questioning the CEO of Microsoft on how this affected their recent relationship with Canonical, who ported Bash and so on over to Windows 10, they say, Canonical is behind Ubuntu, who is moving away from the Linux kernel. Canonical is recently established the idea of Ubuntu BSD. With this acquisition, Canonical and Microsoft are working closely together over the next few years.
Wow.
And so on. Then they have some quotes here from Justin Gibbs, talking about IPv6 and the .NET framework and so on.
Oh, man.
But yeah, you know, the one of the interesting things about this full jokes is obviously that it kind of plays on some of the common misconceptions, like the fact that the FreeBSD Foundation actually owns the source repository. They don't. It's actually maintained by the FreeBSD project, which is separate, on hardware that the foundation maybe pays for, but you know, it is the project's repository, and the foundation has no control over it. But the foundation does do things like take care of the trademark, which requires a single legal entity to do it, whereas the FreeBSD project is this kind of loose collection of, you know, 1,000 people. And a random collection of 1,000 people can't really own a copyright or a trademark. And so, or, you know, sign a contract. And that's why the FreeBSD Foundation exists. And obviously,
I was going to say, we got to point out Open and NetBSD are not necessarily sub-brands of FreeBSD.
No. No. And, you know, even the Ubuntu thing, you know, they didn't just port Bash to Windows 10. They stole the idea of FreeBSD's Linux emulation layer for Windows. And I think the general idea is that you'll be able to run any Linux binary on Windows just like you can do on FreeBSD.
Okay. Hey, you know. ZFS on Windows, though, I see that could still be a cool idea.
Yes.
Maybe now, it'll happen someday.
Yes, someday it'd be very nice if it have access to ZFS on Windows, because then I would just format all of my USB sticks ZFS, and it would work in every operating system, and I'd be very happy.
Yes, I agree. That would be much nicer.
Plus, you know, it's a USB stick. I don't trust it not to have bit flipping going on, right? So ZFS is the obvious choice for a USB stick.
That's right. That's right.
Plus, you know, the big record size helps make sure your USB stick is performant and so on.
Or maybe someday that won't be an April Fool's joke and we'll get that. We'll see. Okay, we got a bunch of Beastie Bits to get to, and we got some comments and questions, of course, from you guys out in the audience. But before we get to that, let's go ahead and hop on to our last sponsor this week, which is going to be Tarsnap. Website for that, tarsnap.com/BSDnow. If you've been any kind of regular listener to this show, you've heard us talking about Tarsnap for, gosh, a couple years now? It's been a while.
It's been a while.
So if you haven't signed up yet, first of all, why not? What's wrong? Like, you need to go do this right now before you lose data.
It's like,
and
you put in $5 and you get secure backup.
Yes.
It sounds too good to be true, but it's not.
You actually get the source code, and it's open source secure backup. Like, that's just mind blowing, right? Like, how could you do that? But Tarsnap does that. So go check it out. If you're paranoid, like many of us are, don't even grab the binaries, even though they have binaries for just about every operating system under the sun, including Cygwin and Windows. Go figure. But you can grab the source code, compile it yourself, so you can be sure that the binary you're running is exactly what it claims to be. So definitely check that out. Put a few bucks in there, and you'll be surprised how long that lasts you, especially when you're backing up data that's not changing a lot.
Yep.
So, definitely will want to grab that. It'll do all the deduplication for you, and then everything's encrypted before it leaves your system, before it goes out over the wire. And nobody on the remote end has your keys. There's no accounting system on that other side where it's like your keys stored up in the cloud somewhere. Don't worry, trust us, it's safe. None of that garbage. So definitely check out Tarsnap today, because that's just the way backups should be done.
Yep. And you know, it's tax season. What important files do you have that you'd really like to not lose, but also not let anybody else see? I can't think of any.
Yeah, right. You There's know? No documents. Or
I know most of us are not like Colin and finished our taxes in January, but you know, for the rest of us,
I did.
I already have my refund too. But I'm just saying, now I need to store my files, and they go up in my Tarsnap, and that's why I can sleep at night.
That's right. That's right. So definitely go get set up with it today, guys. Don't wait.
Yep.
Okay. So let's go into the Beastie Bits here.
Yes.
So first up, we have a story. What's this one about? Credit where credit's due.
Yes. So this is a UK magazine called Linux Voice. In their March 2016 edition, they have an article called The Linux Voice Manifesto. What's right, what's wrong, and how we can change free software for the better. Where the author talks about the disparity between different Linux distributions and all the problems that causes. They hold up the FreeBSD documentation as the way it should be done. In particular, they say, because Linux is put together in a Wild West fashion with lots of different groups like the kernel, glibc, GCC, Xorg, etc., doing their own things, and distro vendors then trying to shoehorn the results together from all those different projects, it's hard to put together a complete and integrated set of documentation that covers every aspect of the operating system. Compare this to FreeBSD, for instance, which has a superb handbook, which kind of provides reference and overview for the entire operating system, because it's developed all in one place and, you know, there's one distribution of it. I say, the FreeBSD handbook is an excellent, well-organized, single-stop shop for documentation, something that many Linux distros would be wise to copy.
Well, that's definitely high praise. So
yeah.
Congrats to the entire doc team. That's a good job. Okay, so next up we have MTier, who provides binary packages for OpenBSD, has provided the instructions to start grabbing those for OpenBSD 5.9. So if you want to grab that, we have the link up on the site here. Looks like they offer two sets of packages. You have pretty much your free version, which is bin patches and stable packages for the most recent release. And then, of course, they have a long-term supported release as well, which you'll need to subscribe to grab. But definitely check out the site if you're looking for the latest goodness for your OpenBSD 5.9 mocks. Okay, so what's up next? We have a nice bug, it looks like, has an upcoming talk.
Yes, sadly we didn't. Sadly we couldn't get this news to you earlier, so that it'd be a little easier for you to get to. But at 6:45 tonight at the Stone Creek Bar and Lounge on 140 East 27th Street in New York, John Wolf will be talking about using LLDB to debug code that you built. LLDB is the next generation high performance debugger and is built as a set of reusable components and you know, highly leveraging existing libraries from the larger LLVM project, such as the Clang expression parser and the LLVM disassembler. It's like now that that's available on OS X and FreeBSD, Linux and Windows, it's definitely time to take a look at it.
Definitely.
And for someone to talk about it, you know, John's been doing compiler development since joining the AT&T Software Development Tools Group at the Unix System Labs in the early 90s, and working on compilers, optimizers, debuggers, and performance tools ever since.
Okay, so next up we have a commit here. It looks like it landed in Dragonfly, where they have implement KQ-based TCP traffic generator.
Yes.
Interesting. It looks like the comment is it's used mainly to generate TCP traffic with large amounts of TCP connections. In other words, greater than 10,000 connections. NetPerf is no longer suitable to generate this kind of TCP traffic since 10,000K processes is not desirable, of course.
Right.
And IPERF 3 is also not suitable since it's implemented using select. So yeah. It looks like they've grown a new feature here. So if you need to do some high performance testing, maybe you want to check that out.
Yeah, I know they've been working a lot on improving how many connections per second you can set up and tear down on Dragonfly. Mm-hmm. And I guess their problem was that, you know, NetPerf would require too many threads or processes to do that. And IPERF is really meant for generating bandwidth, not connections. And so they built a tool based on the BSD KQ. So I think that'll be interesting actually to see that one end up in ports or in the FreeBSD-based system for doing the same thing.
Nice.
Somebody port that.
Yes, yes. Please port that to all the other BSDs. Okay, so next up we have a casual BSD meetup in the Northeast. It looks like this is over in Maryland.
Yes.
At the Ocean City Brewing Company. It looks like they're announcing that for Monday, April 11th. So you still have some time. So
yep.
Next Monday, 6:30 p.m. So we have the link in the show notes. See if you can get out to that if you're in the Maryland area or the DC metro area there. I'm
yep.
sure that's
and,
fairly convenient.
Looking at the list so far, I see it's Michael Shirk who's organizing that. He's a BSD guy I've known for a while. And actually, JT, our producer, will be there as well, since that is in his neck of the woods. So definitely go check it out.
Cool. Okay. So let's see. Next up, we have another Dragonfly. How to get a desktop on Dragonfly, it looks like.
Mm-hmm.
So a link here. It's actually up on the Dragonfly BSD, FreeBSD. Let's see. DragonflyBSD.org site. Sorry,
yes, the official site.
Small here.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, the official Dragonfly site has this tutorial on how to get going with a desktop.
That's right. So it looks like how to set up a package source, how to search for packages, how to install packages, remove, etc. And then they walk you through setting up X windows and, of course, configuring X, important. And then after that, installing desktop environments. And I'm actually pleased to note that Lumina is the first one they mentioned here, which is kind of cool. So good to see that. And, of course, they have Mate, KDE, XFCE4, etc. So definitely check that out if you're looking to spin up a Dragonfly desktop. Okay, so that's the end of... Oh, wait, no, we have the
one
Twitter.
More, yep. Yes.
You got to show the picture, because that's just... The picture is worth 1,000 words right there.
Yeah, so for anyone listening, it shows a pie chart with like 99.9% of it being orange and a sliver of blue. And it says, Linux Programmer's Agenda. The blue, the small sliver, is programming in Linux. And the orange is convincing people to use Linux instead of any other OS. Then on the other side of the screen, it says BSD Programmer's Agenda, with the tiny blue sliver being convince people to use BSD instead of any other OS, and the big orange chunk of the pie being programming in BSD.
So I guess we need to, that's a good thing, but
yes.
It would be nice if we had a little bigger sliver convincing. That, you know, BSD yes. is the best kept secret out there, but I prefer it not to be a secret so
exactly.
much longer.
Yes, it's like, well, I don't want to distract anybody who's doing good work. You know, we could use a marketing team.
Yep. Okay, well, cool. Hey, it's time to get to your feedback and comments here. Mm-hmm. So let's get started with that. So first up this week is Paulo, who writes in. He says, hi, Chris and Alan. I love the show. It's my favorite technical podcast. I like the way all topics are dissected and presented on an easy-to-follow way to the entire audience, even to non-developers like myself. Don't change anything on the show. It's awesome. He says, well, maybe just the intro music. What are we even playing on the intro music?
I have
anymore?
No
I
idea.
I haven't listened to it in so long. JT, if you're listening, I don't know. Maybe we need to switch that.
Yeah, if anybody has a good recommendation on music we could license for that, let us know. That's the hardest part is having the correct rights to actually use yes. the music in the podcast.
Okay. Well, we'll see what we can do.
Yep.
he says, my first contact with FreeBSD was back on release 4.2. I remember getting a CD with it from a PC magazine, installing it on a spare PC I had. I was a Slackware user at the time and switched to FreeBSD ever since. Today, I use FreeBSD for a bunch of different tasks, mostly deployed as VMs on an ESXi host. I am in the process of building a FreeNAS dedicated bare metal box and bought Alan's FreeBSD Mastery ZFS book to get more info before configuring the system. He says he's about a quarter into it. He said, I was hoping you guys could answer a couple questions on ZFS. For disk encryption, can FreeBSD use AES instruction set from AMD processor FX series?
I don't actually know off the top of my head. I imagine they would have made the instruction the same so that it would just work. I don't think it requires any special thing in FreeBSD. Just make sure the ASNI module is loaded.
Yeah.
But I don't know for sure. The way to tell would be... Actually, when Geli starts, it will say either hardware or software crypto in the like three lines of bright white text that come up when you actually do Geli attach. And it will specifically mention if it's using software or hardware to do it.
Okay. He says, also, is there support for or a feature on the roadmap to have encryption per data set? I think a lot of us would like that.
Yeah.
Made the roadmap yet. Some other
story. There was some talk about it at the FreeBSD Storage Summit back in February. And really, a lot of question was about the use cases for that, because certain data, if you were doing per data set encryption, certain data would have to always be unencrypted or encrypted with a separate pool wide key or something. Sure. Or in particular, if you want to only encrypt some data sets and not others, it really doesn't work. And so the current approach with something like Geli is actually kind of the recommended thing. Because there's no point in doing not whole disk encryption, basically. Because otherwise you're always leaking something. While lots of people say they want that, the experts don't agree that it's actually a worthwhile thing. It's hard to say. And then the key management stuff gets kind of difficult with it too, and so on. But there's more and more talk about it. I think there's on GitHub somewhere that somebody's actually started writing some code for it.
Well, now that you have the option to boot with Geli encrypted full ZFS, I think that's a lot more palatable.
Yeah. I'm working on the last set of changes to get that integrated in the installer in time for 11. I've been working on that all week.
How about 11 or UEFI? Is that a thing?
Not yet. I hope to have that done in time for my presentation about it at BSD. Well, my presentation about Geli boot in general, but hopefully for I spent all this weekend resolving a problem where it doesn't work if you were using 4K sectors inside the Geli, which is what the installer's been doing.
Sure.
And I when I set it up manually, I wasn't doing that, and so the ones I built manually worked fine, and then if you use the installer one, it wouldn't work. And a couple other problems. So I've been working on fixing all that. But then I do hope to dig into the EFI stuff and
get that finished. Yeah, when the EFI stuff lands, I will switch my laptop over to it. That just sounds awesome. Okay, so continuing on here, he says, I read Alan's book, the recommendation to make ZFS force using 4K byte sectors for performance. I bumped into this old post, which he sends us a link to below, of someone reporting higher overhead utilization on a fresh pool when doing A shift equals 12 as opposed to A shift equals 9. Yes. I'm not sure if I should force 4K or not, and how do I figure out if my storage providers are reporting the real byte sector?
So, yes, there'll be slightly more overhead, but you're talking about like a number of kilobytes. It's probably not a big deal. If you're writing a lot of very, very small files, like 512 byte files, then maybe there's a downside. But in general, avoiding the write amplification is much better. Even if your drives are currently 512 byte sectors, you know, when those drives die and you replace them later, and you don't want to reformat the whole pool, you probably are going to want to be at 4K sectors anyway, because you can't change the sector size after you create the VDEV.
Sure.
So it's best to do 4K sectors because you don't know how many years you're going to keep this pool. You know, the number of things I wish I knew when I created my pool that I'm still using to this day in 2011. You know, I created a pool in 2011 and it's used in production to this day and is mission critical. And it's like, well,
now you can't change it.
Yeah, it would be really nice if I had done a couple of things differently when I set that up.
When I had set up mine, I had the exact same problem. I had done the HDF9 or didn't do 4K sectors. It was 512. And like within a year, I was regretting that, right? I got new disks in there. I'm like, these are 4K disks.
Or especially when you mix the two, or
That was a total pain.
Yep. His last question, he says he's considering mixing Western Digital Red and Seagate NAS drives of the same size. Any issues or caveats? That's probably fine to do. Specifically, he says his goal is avoiding buying a bunch of the same drives from the same batch that might fail at the same time. So yeah, it's perfectly fine to do that.
Yep.
He says, I don't really care if there's a minimal difference in byte size or something. Yeah, a couple of kilobytes is, you know, if the sector count's not the same, it's okay. As long as you add them all at the same time, it'll work fine. Or, you know, I always do ZFS on a partition drive and use like a gig of that for swap or something. And that way, if the replacement drive is bigger or smaller or whatever, I can adjust the size of that swap partition if I need to avoid having an issue of, oh, the replacement drives you got are actually 3 sectors smaller and now it won't work. So having a little bit of space for that is nice. Plus, you know, having the boot sector on there so you can boot off of it is often handy.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, thanks for sending that in. We appreciate it. All right. So next up is Jonathan. He said, I'd just like to thank you guys and everyone else who's worked on making ZFS so easy to use on FreeBSD/PCBSD, especially with regard to the installer. He said, it's not perfect. He said, for example, PCBSD doesn't let you have multiple VDEVs to start with without dropping in the command line.
Same with FreeBSD, although support for that for mirrors is on the to-do list.
Yeah, we should add that too at some point. So, okay. But he said, overall, it's very easy to use and works very well, even with full disk encryption. He said, this really hit home when I tried to install Linux on a laptop with ZFS the other day. It's possible to install root on ZFS on Linux, even with full disk encryption, but man, is it a pain. Not even Ubuntu, which now has the ZFS driver built in, supports it in their installer. So installing root on ZFS is a bit out of the Wild West at this point. He said, I did finally manage to figure out how to get it working with Arch Linux with root on ZFS and full disk encryption, except for the boot partition, which isn't ZFS, though it's also encrypted. But even with that fairly extensive instructions that are on Arch Wiki, it took a fair amount of trial and error to get it right. He said, ZFS on Linux is behind in other ways. In other words, doesn't support ZFS permissions yet. And I should be just grateful they have ZFS support at all. But the installer situation in particular was night and day that made me so much more grateful for FreeBSD and PCBSD. So a huge thank you to all the devs who made ZFS work as well on FreeBSD and PCBSD as it does. Jonathan. Well, we appreciate that, yeah. Jonathan. We're glad to make it awesome because we all use ZFS and we don't want it to suck either.
So. Exactly. You know, I know personally you and I have both put a lot of work into that particular area. So
Yes. But
lots of other people too.
Yeah, definitely a lot of people are adding to that. And of course, things like multiple VDEV support, I'm sure it'll be got to eventually. But yeah, we would like to have those features. Okay, so next up we have Andrew. He said, hi, Alan and Chris. You guys said last week to send in lots of questions for the double episode, so here we go. He said, I'm looking for a career change. I'm set to go back to school and study comp sci and software engineering in 2017. I'm curious what you guys studied at school to get you where you are. And I guess we'll answer that first. So I started as a computer science major, but actually finished up as a business information systems major. The college I was going to at the time kind of sucked as far as the computer science department. It was very old and out of date, and I was already doing more modern stuff on my own. And I was like, I don't know any of the business stuff. I'd rather learn that. That seemed more interesting, and I would just keep learning the computer science stuff myself. But that was me. Depends on your school. How about you, Alan?
Yeah, kind of similar. I didn't go to university. I went to what in Canada is called a college, but it's almost more of a trade school. Like the other things they teach there is like automotive mechanic and nursing and things like that. But yeah, a College of Arts and Technology, they call it. But I did what they called network engineering and security analysis. But basically, it was sysadmin for Windows, Linux, BSD, Novell at the time. They've since got rid of that part. And then you also learned like Cisco router stuff and some wireless and some virtualization and that kind of stuff. And, you know, just general networking and stuff. But by the time I took that, I was already, part of the reason is I had done some programming, but I kind of taught myself or read tutorials and books and stuff and learned from it. And I figured I could just keep doing that on my own. But to learn networking, I kind of needed, you know, a room full of computers I could network together. And that was what the labs at the college provided to let me do that. And that networking had always been slightly more interesting to me at the time. And so that's why I went to school for that. But mostly, you know, I had already started my first business running BSD and providing hosting to people. And I was just, you know, had to go to school and get some piece of paper to keep my parents happy kind of thing.
Sure.
and I had a good time and learned a bit and, you know, met some interesting people and actually met the professor who's now my business partner. But yeah, so I went for more sysadmin type stuff to kind of a trade school rather than doing the traditional university computer science type thing.
Yeah. He says, before starting my degree, I'd love to get a head start on learning some code. What programming languages would you suggest someone new to learn? Dive into C, C++, or something hot and trendy like Go, or et cetera. So where would you start to learn the basics? So depends on what you want to do, right?
Yeah.
If you plan on hacking on the kernel and doing operating system stuff, C seemed like the logical choice to me.
Yeah. You might also look at the curriculum for what you're going into. A lot of schools use Java, and so it might give you a leg up to start with that. But at the same time, you know, if they're going to start at the beginning with Java, then maybe you want to start with something else so that you're not bored for the first year of Java.
Sure.
You know?
So I think growing up, I started with BASIC.
Yeah, I did QBASIC.
QBASIC.
I switched to Visual Basic 4 and then 6. And then I did a bit of C, although I didn't really understand what I was doing in C, but I had done enough like PHP and Perl that I understood how, you know, if, while, you know, all those were. Yeah, I just didn't understand pointers yet. I didn't understand what pointers and the printf things were very confusing. But I did enough that I could, like, I took the IRC server source code and changed some ifs around or added some extra ifs or added an extra flag to a struct or whatever and made it so that, you know, the IRC server would spit out Star Trek messages instead of the regular ones, or, nice. You know, add some new user flag that would make me like the super administrator so I could do whatever I wanted kind of thing. A bunch of little stuff like that, but yeah.
Yeah, I think mine was, like I said, basic C, a little bit of PHP is what I probably got into, and then C++ I dove into a little later. I did some visual C++ for a while on Windows and then transitioned that into doing Qt. On actually, of all places, go Unix at the time because we were doing a graphical utility for a proprietary app. So that was fun. But, you know, pick something, just get started. Once you kind of learn the logic of it, that's good. And then hopefully it makes it easier to transition to new languages at that point.
Yep.
And of course, where do you start? Google or the internet is a good first place to start. Your local bookstore, Amazon, go buy a book. All the stuff I learned early on was out of a book and then basically sitting in front of a system, you know, one of my little test systems and just hacking on it. And over time, you figure stuff out.
Yep. You know, example code is nice. Mm-hmm. Part of the problem of looking at some of the example code in FreeBSD is some of it is very old and written in a kind of a more arcane way and hacky and stuff. But if you find some of the nice stuff like procstat is beautifully written. It's all laid out very nice. You know. Example code is, I found very useful to understanding some of the stuff too.
Yep.
Just kind of reading the code and understanding what it does and why it works the way it does helps you understand a lot.
So he said, without reigniting the editor wars, what setups do you use to write code? So I started in VI and I use Vim right now. Not the graphical, just Vim and a shell prompt. That's all I need.
Yeah.
What do you think, Tom?
For me, most of the major code editing I do, I use a graphical editor called Komodo Edit. Mostly out of habit, I started with it because it had good support for PHP with all the like syntax highlighting stuff, but actually integration with the PHP debugger. So it would actually find syntax errors and highlight them in the editor while I was still writing the code and stuff and have completion for all the PHP functions and so on. It actually is not good at C, so I'll probably look at something different, but I'm just so used to it. And I know how to use it. I'm pretty happy with it. Plus, it's portable. They have versions for Windows, Linux, BSD, Solaris, etc. So it's nice when I switch between my Windows machine and my PCBSD machine, I use the same web browser, the same editor, everything. And it makes my life easier that way.
See, I guess I never really got into the visual editors too much. I mean, I started with Pico back in the day. Like,
right. I still use Nano for editing config files.
Okay. But then after that, I went to SCO, and it was like VI all the way. And so I did that for years. And it was only in the last year or two I switched to Vim just to get color. Like, that's all I use it for. I don't care about anything else. I just like the color, so it highlights certain things in Shell or in C++ or stuff.
The main thing I love about my visual editor is things like click on the opening curly brace, and it highlights the closing curly brace.
Yeah, yeah, which is nice.
Yeah.
All right, he asked if there's any word on when Asia BSD Con videos would be available. I know
that Hiroki's been very busy the last couple of weeks with catching up with stuff he was putting off because he was doing the conference. So hopefully sometime next month. Hopefully I don't know. No promises.
Okay. Well, cool. Well, actually, that's it for us today then. Yes. As we wrap up the show here, we're going to remind you to send your questions, comments, show ideas. Of course, if you have a topic, something you want us to talk about, or if you find a story floating around the net, do go ahead and send those into us. We don't mind getting duplicates. We'd rather have it too many times than not at all and completely mess the story. So send it in, feedback@bsdnow.tv. That's the email we monitor. We'd love it if you'd send your comments in. We'll try and read it on a future episode of the show. And, of course, keep those coming. We appreciate it. So stick around next week again for that tease we had. Some special video we're hoping to present to you guys. Mm-hmm. So looking forward to that.